In this video, we'll look at the things you should consider when thinking about 3D printing something. Can you even print the part you want to make? What should your environment look like where you print stuff? And what do you need for equipment and tools to work with the machine and with the final prints? Okay, let's get right into it and start with the models themselves. Over the years, 3D printers have become a lot better when it comes to what they can and cannot print, but there are still a few limitations and best practices. To understand where those come from, you need to keep in mind how these machines work and, you know, how that immediately affects the output they produce. And thankfully, when you run into a limitation, you can usually just wash the print and you'll see what's going wrong. So for a filament printer to work, it needs to first heat up and extrude filament through a nozzle. That nozzle has a set orifice size, and because molten plastic is highly viscous, it can't immediately start and stop extruding. There's always a bit of a ramp up and ramp down as the pressure inside the hot end builds and releases. Also, as the plastic comes out of the nozzle and as it cools down to ambient temperature, it shrinks and contracts. So, a few things that result from that. First, it's really hard to reproduce details that are basically just little dots of filament, you know, like these, where they have a very thin cross-section on each layer, or similar small features like these handles on miniature characters. This was printed with a very large nozzle, so these details are relatively large still. That also applies to text that's going to be printed on its own layer. And for text, it is almost always better to emboss it instead of raising it. And when it comes to fine features like these, anything that has a wall thickness of 2 to 4 times the nozzle size is usually going to print just fine. If it's a consistent thin wall, going down to 1x the nozzle diameter can work too, depending on your slicer and its setup, but especially with softer filaments, long super thin walls can become quite floppy and end up with this wavy structure that you see here. Now, because of how plastic shrinks as it cools, you get a few effects that can warp your prints out of shape. This is not so much an issue when you're just printing PLA, but as materials get more temperature resistant, like PETG and then ABS and then polycarbonate, its tendency to warp and to lift off the print bed during prints also increases. Models that have a strong core but only little contact area towards its edges are most likely to have issues here. For the next one that's temperature related, curling, we should probably look into overhangs first. Curling usually happens on an overhang. Let me see which one is the worst here. I think this one's pretty bad. And overhangs themselves are actually the main consideration when determining if a part can be printed or not. As a filament printer lays down a line of material, it will always need something to attach it to. Normally, that's the layer underneath. And of course, there needs to be some overlap between those two so that the new layer is supported properly. In practice, that means that there is a limit to what angle the underside of your prints can be before it will start to cause issues. And that angle is the overhang angle. The classic and still safe rule used to be 45 degrees from horizontal, so 45 degrees tilting up. But as the hardware and software has improved, you can now usually do 30 degrees, which is a lot shallower, without too much trouble. Something that it can definitely not do is to have a negative angle where, as you trace a path from the print bed up, your part starts dipping down again. As the print gets built up, that spot down there would be, you know, printed onto thin air, which obviously isn't going to work. You need to use support material right there. So back to curling. Basically, that's what you get when your overhang is too steep for your combination of printer, filament, and print setting. It's most obvious at edges where two overhanging areas meet and create a steeper compound overhang. One really cool thing that printers can do, where you can cheat on all this a bit, is bridging, where the printer can stretch a single line of filament over a gap. But for that to work, the start and end points need to be on the exact same height, aka on the same layer, so the underside of those needs to be perfectly horizontal. Now, of course, we could go into a lot more detail here with design rules, etc., but a lot of it comes down to just actually trying different things and seeing what works and what doesn't. All these rules can be stretched a lot depending on how exactly your models are made and how well your printer prints. So, when it comes to the environment that you're printing in, that one goes both ways. First, the things that the printer itself needs to work well. You need a flat table for it to sit on, and an overall not too cold or drafty and not too humid atmosphere. A normal room is usually fine. After all, that's what these machines and materials are made for. But if you have an air conditioning vent directly blowing on your printer, or you're living in a particularly hot and humid area, those things might become an issue. Too low of a temperature is easy to fix though. Just drop your printer in a box and it will heat itself up enough to work even with the higher temperature filaments. For the other requirements about your workspace, I guess I should mention that printers with a moving bed will extend past their packing size, so a deep work surface is highly recommended. 80 centimeters or 4-link deep gives you plenty of space. You can see how much space this actually takes up. And you know, when it comes to actual workshop use, try to keep it in a space where it won't get dust, wood or metal shavings, or grinder sparks thrown at it. One thing that I rarely think about, because it's not really an issue here, is power outages. So if you're doing longer prints and your printer doesn't have a power panic feature, you might want to look into getting a UPS to plug your printer into. Now, if you look at it the other way around, there are some details that might make printing more comfortable, not for the printer, but for you. I'm talking emissions here, of which you've got noise and vibrations, as well as smell and fumes. Let's start with noise. And like I said, printers actually vary a lot between different models and how exactly they sound. You've got some nearly silent printers, then you've got some where the fans are the loudest thing, then you have some that cause vibrations, and some that emit a high-pitched whine, driving Generation Y and Z crazy, as well as your cats and dogs. Vibrations are fairly easy to mitigate by using a weighted plate and a piece of foam to rest your printer on. For other noise, again, you can use a box, but for a lot of printers with that, I still wouldn't want to have it sitting next to me on my desk. And that's not just because of noise, but also because of smell and the particles printers emit. There is some research that suggests that filament printers emit a considerable amount of particles, even when printing PLA. I don't know exactly how harmful those particles are, but filaments like PLA, ABS, and nylon are some that you can definitely smell, and their fragrance isn't always particularly pleasant. So between the noise and the smell, I've relegated my working printers to their own little room, which is right past that wall. Right now it doesn't have any ventilation in there, it should, but it's got a door that I can close and not worry about it. I'm also keeping all my filaments in there and the moisture sensitive ones in dry boxes, which makes a massive difference in just being able to reliably print stuff from those. Now, I've got this OSB box in here with an old Mark II and a multi-material one on it, so that it's always ready to rock. In the video where I set this thing up, some of you pointed out that using wood as a box might be an issue because it burns. Well, that's what wood does, which is a somewhat valid point. Now, wood doesn't catch on fire as easily as one might think, and printers almost never fail so badly that they will burn up, but some less reputable brands have had a handful of their printers more or less spontaneously ignite themselves, and because they were using plastic frames, that caught on fire, and as a result, a couple of houses almost burnt down. Now, again, that's an extremely rare occurrence, and for example, on the Mark III, I know that there are checks and extra sensors in place that prevent that exact failure mode, but still, these are machines that contain relatively high power heaters, and it doesn't hurt to be safe about it. At the very least, have a smoke detector correctly mounted near your printer and make sure you can actually hear it when it goes off. You can get wireless ones that will trigger all the other alarms in the house if one goes off. But also try not to keep any highly flammable materials next to your printer, like that would be dumb. If you're worried about, for example, you know, this wooden box, have a look at building code and, for example, use a sheet of drywall on the inside to create a fire barrier. It also goes without saying that it's not exactly recommended to leave your printers unattended for long periods of time. Like, even though I trust most of the printers I actually use, I wouldn't start a 2-week print and then leave the printer while I go on vacation. As far as the printer itself throwing stuff around, you'll quite often find these priming lines scattered around the printer, as well as, you know, the filament change, doodads, blobs, and if you're printing with support material, you know, I've got one right here, you're gonna find pieces of that as you snap them off. Those can fly pretty far. So maybe avoid carpet floors because those bits can get stuck in there and stepping on them isn't pleasant. Lastly, if you're using a spray-on bed adhesive, got one back here, always apply that outside of your printer. So take out the glass or metal bed and spray that on away from the printer and away from any other surfaces that you don't want to get covered in, well, basically hairspray. Now, what tools should you have to work on and with a 3D printer? Well, really, it's not much. Here, many printers actually include things like a hex key set, needle nose pliers, and maybe even some of the common size wrenches that you need for example, a nozzle swap on a hot end. For that, one of these little torque wrenches does come in extremely handy if you don't quite have the feel for how tight a hot end should be assembled, because if you give that too much oomph, it is really easy to damage it. But back to basic tools, like I said, you know, hex keys, got some right here, some common pliers, needle nose ones, a side cutter, maybe a flush cutter, bunch of screwdrivers, and wrenches in common sizes. Let me just grab one. You don't really need all that much. Basic hand tools, really. For maintenance, the most you're likely going to do is maybe retightening a few bits here and there. But even if you decide to dive in a bit deeper and get modifying, just these tools should take you a long way. Maybe one more 3D printer specific tool if you don't have a flex bed, some way to remove prints. Either a thin sharpened spatula, a dull one isn't going to do anything for you because you're not going to be able to get it under your prints. And I've also got this nice strip of steel, which I don't know where it is right now, so I'll show you a bit of archive footage. It's got a really nice edge on it, and I forgot who exactly I got it from, but it's thin enough to just slide under a print and basically shear off the adhesion without just pulling up, which would risk pulling up the bed surface along with it. So if you're looking for a print removal tool, look for something you can really slide under your part, and not something like a chisel where it gets real steep real quick, or something with a really dull edge. Like, that's not going to slide under your prints. Let's recap. The most basic requirements for printable designs are to avoid details smaller than about 2 times your printer's nozzle size. And for large parts printed with high temperature filaments, warping might become an issue too. For all prints, overhangs should stay over 30 degrees, less steep than 30 degrees, from horizontal. Provide a flat, stable, and large enough surface for your printer, and make sure temperature and humidity stay in a range that you would also consider comfortable. If you're happy, your printer is too. Be aware of noise, smell, and particle emissions of your printer, and take reasonable precautions against a fire hazard. And lastly, if you have some basic tools, you're all set on that front. So that's it for this one. In the next video, we'll look at common print issues and solutions to them. Until then, thank you for watching. Make sure to get subscribed, keep on making, and I will see you later.